So we were continuing with this thread on reasoning and argumentation. And last time before we finished, I was trying to frame not just why we think that the act of engaging in rhetoric or different forms of public argumentation are important to different social, political, or economic settings. But we were also trying to take a skeptical view about some situations where there might actually be reasons to be skeptical about the utility of argumentation also. So ordinarily, we say that argumentation helps in pursuing the truth, because until and unless you hear from different points of view, unless you allow an entire diversity of views to be expressed on a certain issue, it's not very clear as to what would be the best course of action. And it is through engagement in the process of discussion, dialogue, responding to differences, that we work out what might be a more viable and more acceptable course of action for a group as a whole. So we specifically focused on the deliberative nature of public speaking or oratory, where one of the other objectives is that not only do people feel that they have a voice when it comes to collective decision making, but the actual decisions themselves then reflect the viewpoints or the reasoned disagreements of the people who took part, and hence are more likely to be accepted. So this is one of the central premises of modern democratic arrangements, that acts of collective participation are more likely to be seen, or decisions made on the basis of collective participation, I beg your pardon, are more likely to be seen as acceptable and binding on people in the long run. Now, of course, if you try and compare the truth-seeking function with the consensus-building function, it's quite likely that there are many situations where the building of consensus, in fact, is prioritized, and the pursuit of the truth sometimes takes a backseat, as we find very often when it comes to the realm of commercial advertising. And obviously, given our understanding of modern electoral politics, even political parties and elected leaders very often resort to the prioritization of consensus building, which very often comes at the cost of the truth. So there is, of course, a much deeper insight into these questions about how the mass media or other methods of knowledge creation are often used to build a consensus, often around theories which are unviable or positions which may actually be harmful in the long run. And that is part and parcel of how knowledge is created, disseminated, and then revisited over time. So apart from that big picture view, it's also important to acknowledge that there could be some social situations or situations where there is a deep imbalance of power between different groups or different interests, where argumentation can in fact be an instrument of harm. So which is why I said that think very closely about some of the points which I'm making here. Of course, you may relate them to examples which you are more familiar with, but you can possibly see situations where the ability to put forward evidence, information, and ideas in one place may not just be used for constructive ends, such as informing the public or passing on knowledge to others, but can also be used for destructive ends, as we find in the case of propaganda, whether it is on behalf of business interests or organized political parties for that matter. So very simply, Socrates, who often offered several views on the state of life and his analysis on social relations in the oral tradition, then subsequently found that many of his writings were in fact written down by his disciples like Plato, and then Plato's disciple was Aristotle. And some of these ideas are found in the works of these ancient Greek scholars. So we're just picking out a few, but I'm sure there are many others which you can explore, especially if you read some of the original texts which are available. So sophistry can go to the extent of rationalizing tyranny. Excessive skepticism and arguments can create hurdles for decision making, making it difficult to act with expediency, which means that sometimes the ability to look at a certain issue from multiple sides might be beneficial, because it helps you in covering a standpoint or a line of reasoning which was otherwise not explored. But it's also possible that it can obstruct or delay decision making where such efficient decision making is required. And lastly, of course, those who identify with the profession of advocacy. I mean, of course, modern lawyers are one category, but we can see different forms of advocacy in our lives, whether it is social advocacy, whether it is lobbying on behalf of businesses, whether it is election campaigns. We are constantly interacting with and receiving information from people who are engaging in different kinds of advocacy. Of course, being law students, our primary focus is on advocacy in the courtroom. But there are other kinds of advocacy also that happen in the various professions and social settings. So the other big criticism is that those who specialize as advocates or rhetoricians are like clouds, and they can pretty much argue different positions depending on their short-term interests. So then moving on to the idea that that we do look at the place of rhetoric and argumentation, not just in terms of what it does in the short run, in terms of making decisions more acceptable, or in terms of disseminating a particular point of view or a certain position, but it also has a macro effect on how societies view themselves and the way in which we analyze the notion of authority in a society. So, of course, there is an older argument that it is only through the expansion of literacy, the expansion of the ability to read, write, and publish your work, that there is a large-scale challenge to the authority of the organized church. Because for most of the European nations in the medieval period, the ability to write, publish, or disseminate your views was limited to the priestly class, or limited to people who were involved with organized religion. So it's only with the printing press and then the gradual development of the university system and modern education that people from other backgrounds also started gaining the ability to read, write, and publish their work. And by the 19th century, of course, you started seeing even movements for organized labor and movements for women's voting rights emerging in a big way in many European nations. And one of the main reasons for that was not just the expansion of literacy, but also the expansion of the published the published word, which means it became, with the passage of time and with the improvement of technology, it became cheaper to publish books, to publish newspapers, and gradually they became means of asking questions of the incumbent government, but also to question existing social mores and traditions. So in a country like India, of course, we have not gone through such a linear transition in terms of the movement from a closed system of knowledge to a more open system of knowledge. In fact, one would argue that given the high levels of illiteracy, or given the lack of awareness about many forms of published news, you may still find that India, in fact, has numerous communities which live in their own information bubbles. But obviously, with the growth of the internet and the extent of the penetration of mobile phones, we are dealing with a very different kind of reality in our situation. So it's not just a question of holding the state accountable or questioning existing traditions, but very often we find that means of mass communication are deployed by members of particular communities or members of particular interest groups, sometimes to entrench their own views and to propagate them. So India is not really the same, cannot really be compared to the way in which many of these Western societies have undergone a transition from religious beliefs to what we often identify with ideas of modern secularism. The reality in India, of course, is far more complex. So these were some background points which we have spoken about at length. And as I said, since the presentation is available with most of you, you're quite free to think of ideas or problems that you think you might encounter with your own research queries. And even in general, as you study for the other subjects which are more specialized, which are particular to a certain field, it may help in seeing what strategy of argumentation is being used by a particular author in front of you, and how you would construct a response either in your own writing or in your discussion. So that those were the larger objectives of talking about this content in the last couple of classes. But now I want to move on to a slightly different thread, which is also marked in the same presentation, but also is linked to some ideas that we'll further explore in the coming few classes. As I said, I want to spend some time on approaches to argumentation, which is what we are doing, which is what we have done for some hours last week and most of this week. Then we'll get into the norms of the norms of writing in terms of what is expected in terms of the norms of citation, what is expected in terms of the structure of your seminar papers, and how exactly can you sharpen and refine the literature review that you have to conduct when you engage in a substantive act of academic writing. So that, of course, was part of the outline that we went through. And broadly, I'll try and follow that thematic structure as we go across the coming 3 weeks. So let me just spend some time on what I think is a very normal and acceptable way of putting forward an argument. And since most of you will be engaging in written work, at least in our course this time, since we are running a shorter semester with classes over less than 3 months, the assessment is entirely based on assignments. There is no exam. In the previous 5 years, we have had an end term exam as well. And sometimes some students do find that exam to be difficult because they're not quite accustomed to write in an argumentative way. Generally, I find that many LLM students have a habit of simply repeating information or repeating the opinions which are discussed in class because they might have taken accurate notes. But the nature of the questions that we often ask are not just about that. It's also about forming your opinion on the issue in front of you and the ability to dissect it and analyze it in a structured way. So in a way, what I'm about to say is helpful in an indirect way if you do attempt exams in a proper in autonomous law school. But more immediately, I would say it's important to pay attention to these slides because it may help you in framing your seminar papers and even your research proposals, which you will be working on in the next couple of weeks, right? So when we talk about the construction of arguments, remember, these are ideas which you can use for constructing a speech when you're preparing a speech. And as I said, our immediate objective is to help you in writing your seminar papers and your research proposals, which will be due after that sometime in January. So generally, when you talk about, let's say, an opinion piece, let's take the opinion piece as the basic form of legal writing, and then we'll expand that into what the expectations are of a scholarly article, which is the model for a seminar paper. Generally, an opinion piece, let's say, which focuses on a particular case or a particular legislation, which is the most easy way of trying to begin your work, would it normally begin with a recounting of the background to a certain problem or the background to a certain legal dispute, right? So you might state the relevant facts or the history of that issue, followed by a statement of the central argument and the position. That is, if you have a central argument or a position where you're offering an opinion, but there might be some pieces of writing where you're not really offering a central argument, but you're trying to survey what others have said, or you're simply trying to explain an existing concept or an existing idea or an existing set of events to a larger audience. So I'm not talking about explanatory writing. I'm not talking about situations where you're summarizing or thematizing what others have done. I'm talking about a situation where you're preparing an opinion piece or a shorter article for others to read. So usually you would begin your piece by stating what you think is the background or the history to that particular issue, followed by a statement of what your overarching position is. As I said, even when we spoke about the logical form of arguments, this is usually how you would start. Then you would have some assertions, which means that there might be a statement of an idea in support of the central argument or position. And depending on the complexity of the topic that you have picked, there might be more than one assertion. It may not just be a single assertion. There might be multiple assertions which back up the central argument or the position that you're taking. Then the process, which I guess is the core of reasoning and something which only takes can be developed with time, practice, and looking at how others have dealt with it, which is the process of reason giving or substantiation. I mean, they mean the same thing. So I'm just using the word reason giving because I think it's easier to communicate it and easier for us to understand what is required. So this point we have made earlier as well. So I'm just repeating myself that use a logical form to develop, ordinarily use a logical form to develop or demonstrate causal links in your arguments, which means one proposition should normally feed into another. Or even when you're analyzing a certain point, a certain position should lead itself to other positions ordinarily. Of course, there might be evidence or there might be contradictory arguments, which may then also help you break the chain of causal reasoning. But causal links and causal reasoning is the basic form in which you write in an academic legal paper. So we did speak about some of the methods of logical reasoning earlier. Even in Dr. Uma's classes, you did spend some time on it. And we did say that the three basic forms of logical reasoning are deductive syllogisms, inductive generalizations, and reasoning by analogies. So deductive syllogisms are when you begin with a major premise and a minor premise, and then you combine it to form a certain conclusion. And generally, you move from a general or set of observations to a more particular conclusion. Inductive generalizations work in the opposite direction, which means you have a fixed set of observations about a particular set of people, objects, or processes. And based on those specific observations, you then start generalizing and theorizing what the larger trend or what the larger phenomenon is. And then you try to explain what is happening. So induction seems to be a movement from a general reality to a particular conclusion, right? Or what I said in my previous notes was a general set of observations then moves to helps you in moving towards a particular set of inferences and eventually findings. Whereas inductive generalization works in the opposite direction, where you begin with specific and particular observations about people, processes, institutions. And those specific set of observations over time are then used to arrive at more general conclusions or general findings about what is going on. So deduction and induction are the two very basic steps in constructing arguments in a logical form. And you also have reasoning by analogies, which is extremely important in doctrinal legal research, because very often you're comparing a certain situation with something that has happened in the past. So especially when we talk about the idea of precedent or the idea of stare decisis in common law, which is that newer courts are bound by decisions made by the same court earlier. Similarly, when we talk about the binding nature of precedent, we often say that lower courts are bound to follow the decisions made by higher courts in the judicial hierarchy. So these are all examples of reasoning by analogy, because you're either comparing the facts in front of a court or the facts of a particular case with previously decided cases and what kind of fact patterns were brought to the court. Or sometimes you are even using analogies in a more expansive way, because you might be comparing the evolution of a rule or the evolution of an institution in your country with how similar rules and institutions have emerged in other parts of the world. So it's not just comparisons within your own jurisdiction, where you compare events in the past or decisions made in the past or fact patterns in older cases with what is happening now, because that is a comparison between different objects or processes in time. But you can also have comparisons across locations, not only when you study comparative law, where you compare facts, let's say, pending before a court with another case which has a similar content in another part of the world or another country. But remember, comparisons can also happen within a country, especially in a country like India, where you have multiple states and multiple high courts. Very often, high courts are looking at decisions from other states, which may be helpful or applicable in understanding the issue in front of them. So reasoning by analogies is actually a pretty useful and very common form of argumentation for lawyers. And very often you begin reasoning by analogy in a more simplistic way. I mean, when we speak about looking at precedents or looking at comparative law sources, we are talking about reasoning by analogy in a more advanced form. But we can have reasoning by analogy in a very simplistic form, where you simply point out similarities or differences between the two objects or persons or institutions that are in front of you. So as I said, I won't say much about this method, because we do have a full course on comparative public law, which will be taught in the next semester, which will start on 18th January and will probably go on till the first week of May. And in that course itself, I will be engaging around 20 hours, where we will be focusing specifically on the methodology of research in comparative law. So that's again a theme which in a way will help me develop some of the material that we are covering in December. But I will probably again interact with you in the second half of March and April, where we will focus simply on the methodology of studying comparative law, which unfortunately is an area that is not taught in many Indian law schools. I know there are many people who say that they're teaching comparative law, but then it's reduced to citing a few cases which are relevant to the controversy in front of them. And to be very completely honest, very few Indian law schools are focusing on the study of comparative law with the kind of attention that it deserves. Right? Even in Nalsar, only in the recent past, we have had some visiting professors offering courses in comparative constitutional law. But it hasn't really gotten the kind of attention that it deserves. Partly it has to do with the way in which Indian law schools interact with people from other countries or other nations. And also it has something to do with the ability and the background of the faculty members. Because unfortunately, in many Indian law schools, people have not had the opportunity either to study abroad or to engage with foreign legal sources. So that's another limitation that many of our sister schools have. So that is an advantage that Nalsar will give you. It might seem like a very difficult subject. In fact, the feedback that we've got in the last few years is that the comparative public law course is possibly the most difficult course, much more difficult than what you're having this semester. And it was partially in recognition of that feedback that we moved that course to the second semester, because earlier we were doing all the three mandatory courses in the first semester. So because of the students' feedback and their points that the material in comparative public law was harder to grasp, that's why we changed the order and moved one course to the second semester. Anyway, that's more to do with the way in which our LLM is structured, and I'm sure by now you have a good sense of what you have gotten into. So then, of course, as I said, as part of the process of reason giving, it's important to think about what kind of evidence you are bringing to bear on your act of writing. And remember, evidence in the legalist sense is limited to how you think about the submission of eyewitness testimony, the submission of documents. And now increasingly the emphasis is on forensic evidence, which are different forms of physical evidence. But we are now talking about evidence in a slightly more open-ended way, that even if, let's say, you were presenting a seminar paper or you were taking part in a debate or a moot court, you would still require some kind of evidence to support your arguments. So citing or presenting empirical data is one form of evidence. And as you saw in certain fields like economics or development economics or sociology or anthropology, almost the entire nature or structure of the discipline is based on what methods you would use to collect empirical data, how to sort it, how to organize it, how to present it. And that, of course, becomes a fairly important field of knowledge, even when we talk about empirical approaches to legal research. But generally, when we talk about doctrinal research, we not only try to piggyback on empirical data, which is generated by people from other disciplines, but we also try and pick out representative examples from the case laws, from the situations in front of us. And we also try to pick out what might be verifiable experiences across a certain group, because you engage in that act of generalized reasoning, especially when you create legislation or rules to govern a particular situation. So we can speak a little bit more about what we mean by the normative content of rules. I'm sure Professor Handa would have spoken to you about the Hart-Fuller debate, about how HLA Hart and Fuller fundamentally disagreed on how to characterize the structure and purpose of rules in a modern legal system. And even though her own opposition is slightly skeptical about this older debate in legal theory, it is still a debate which I think the textbook that you're covering, Margaret Davies, covers quite well. So we're not going to get into that discussion on how the HLA Hart and Lon Fuller debate proceeded in the 1960s. But there is something to be said about the major disagreement that they had about the nature of law in the first place, right? HLA Hart fundamentally argued that the law is a closed system. Questions about authority or legitimacy have to be worked out within the existing hierarchy of rules. And you have something called a distinction between primary rules, which are directly enforceable on us, and secondary rules, which form the underpinning of the rules which are directly enforced on us. And in talking about the secondary rules, he distinguished between a rule of recognition, a rule of adjudication, and a rule of change, which are functions which any modern legal system must perform, so that rules are not only flexible and they change as per the needs of society, but there's also a mechanism for deciding on the disputes, not just on facts, but also about the content of those rules. And most importantly, there must be a rule of recognition, which means that there must be a well laid down process by which legal rules gain validity or in a particular system. So HLA Hart is described as what we call an inclusive legal positivist, because by and large, he's defending the older view of legal positivism with some modifications to account for deep social and economic changes. On the other hand, Lon Fuller, whose arguments you must have also looked at, presents a very different argument on the nature of law. And he argues that law and moral judgments in society cannot be strictly separated. In fact, there's bound to be a substantial overlap between existing traditions, social morals, and prevailing customs with the way in which we imagine the authority of law. And there is something called the inner morality of law, which touches on some basic standards of regulating human conduct, which no legal system should compromise. So their debate is pretty complicated, and I don't think we have the time to unpack what each of them were saying, either in their own books or in response to each other. But for some of you who have studied jurisprudence systematically in your first course, you would remember in your bachelor's degree, you might remember that the Hart-Fuller debate is brought up quite often in the modern literature on jurisprudence in terms of how we theorize the function of law. So I'm not going to say too much on that, but even the process of argumentation, reason giving, or evidence presentation that you would engage in doctrinal legal research can actually be sharpened or refined if you have some familiarity with those debates in legal philosophy. In fact, those connections are not very easy to make when you study them at the initial stages. But I guess one of the reasons why we have the course on law and justice and the course on research methods happening at the same time is to be able to help you see those connections as you start developing your work. So obviously, at the moment, my objectives are very limited. I'm just talking about a general structure that you should try and follow when you're constructing arguments in your seminar papers. And obviously, apart from reason giving, which is the most important part, the use of evidence, which sometimes can be strategic, you must also then emphasize the significance of how you have constructed your reasons, what kind of evidence you have cited, and tie it back to the central argument or the larger position that you are taking in your paper. So this is just a rough structure. We'll, of course, see some examples, as I have promised, so that we have a better sense of how to apply this in our own writing. Now, let me just go through the next slide before we pause for questions, because both of these slides actually need to be read together. So when we talk about construction of arguments, remember a large amount of time, especially in legal argumentation, especially in argumentation which has an adversarial character, is also spent on the construction of rebuttals or refutation. And as law students, this is something that we start doing intuitively as soon as we encounter moot court memorials or competing positions, or sometimes, as of course, as some of you have gained experience, you would have also found when you draft documents or when you prepare for court. So some of the usual methods which are used, and of course, not all methods can be used together in the same situation. These are just some suggestions on how we normally construct rebuttals or refutation. There are some examples which we can think of in a more systematic way. So when you're responding to somebody, you may point out logical irrelevance. You may find that the person has either not applied logic coherently, or even the way in which logical reasoning has been applied in what somebody else has said is not really relevant to the issue that you're discussing, right? Then you could have a way of constructing rebuttals or refutation where you point out the insignificance of what the other party has said with respect to the issue at hand, right? You can say, fine, you are right in terms of how you're presenting your point of view or how you're advancing the argument on behalf of your client, but what you're saying is not directly relevant to the issue that we are considering right now. So this happens very often, especially in moot courts, right? Where the issues are limited and the legal questions are framed in advance. Then, of course, you can offer rebuttals or refutation based on factual inaccuracies. But these days, with the nature of news and the nature of disinformation that does the rounds, sometimes, right, you also have the problem of alternative facts, which means that the other side doesn't quite agree on what are the basic facts that should play a role in having a discussion. Then you can respond to others by pointing out unsubstantiated assertions that certain positions or ideas have been adopted, have been offered, but there's no real process of reason giving or substantiation which helps you to understand why that argument is convincing or what in particular should persuade you about what the other side is saying. Then the fifth category, which I guess is the foundation of what we call the critical legal studies approach, which is questioning the underlying assumptions, which means that even if the logic that is being offered by the other side is consistent, is coherent, even if the other side has given you convincing examples to illustrate the ideas that they want you to agree with, it's quite possible that the other side has made certain assumptions about the subject matter in front of them, or has a certain belief system or value system, which itself is ignoring the needs or points of view of other groups. So especially when we talk about critical legal studies and the kind of scholarship that is generated around questions of caste or religion or gender, or for that matter, sexual orientation or disability, very often we find that rulemaking by the legislature or the exercise of discretion by civil servants often is premised on the belief that most people are either able-bodied or most people are male, or for that matter, most people are from a dominant richer section. And very often the perspective of the underclass, the perspective of the disadvantaged worker, the perspective of the woman trapped in a patriarchal household are not adequately considered. And the assumptions that are informing lawmaking in themselves can be questioned. So this is an approach which I hope you are learning and you're thinking a bit more about in the Law and Justice course, because that is the real value addition which that course has given to LLM students in the last few years. And I hope that you make the most of Professor Dhanda's teaching this semester, because as you know, she is formally retiring after January. So questioning underlying assumptions is not something, again, which comes to people naturally, or it doesn't come to people intuitively. It, again, is a skill that can be developed with practice, with exposure, and a willingness to learn, right? So this is something which I can just say in a more generic way, but I'm sure you would have already encountered examples where you were given a certain point of view, you were given a certain argument, and rather than responding to the argument in a literal way or pointing out the fallacies in reasoning in that argument, you were asked to question the underlying assumption behind that statement or behind that argument, right? Then the method which I guess lawyers are most comfortable with is disputing causation. That a line of arguments or a line of reasoning presented to you appears to be convincing on first glance, but a more careful scrutiny will show that the causal linkages in that argument are not particularly well developed, or sometimes you disagree with the way in which the other side has constructed their reasoning. Then, of course, a method which these days has a lot of visibility on social media, which is pointing out contradictions in what other sides say. And very often this point is taken to logical extremes, where people often travel beyond the issue that is in front of them and start engaging in the problem of what we call whataboutry. That you are taking a certain stance today, but you were not constructing your position in the same way when it came to a previously decided issue or something that happened in the past. Now, this is a very dangerous line of argumentation, because normally whataboutry is resorted by people not to act, move forward, or not to resolve issues in the present, but to somehow bring up events in the past which may or may not be related to the subject matter in front of you, because you want to persuade your audience or you want to convince the other side that they are being inconsistent and hence they should not be believed, or hence their arguments are not convincing. Now, the point is that there might be some situations where pointing out contradictions in what your opponents or your rivals say is useful, because they themselves might have a slightly confused line of reasoning, or they themselves may not have clarified or adequately thought about what they need to do. But when you start using whataboutry to shut down voices which are speaking up on behalf of minority or disadvantaged groups, when you start using whataboutry to simply silence conversations and to prevent people from speaking, then it can also become an adjunct to authoritarian behavior. And we see this happening very often on social media, where sometimes people are being questioned for statements or views which they offered when they themselves were much younger, or they themselves were handling a very different situation. And somehow the strategy of rebuttal or refutation concentrates on pointing out some abstract similarity between that past situation and the current situation. To take an example which has been discussed, I think, very often in the last 4 years, many people say that the criticism against Prime Minister Modi for his act of complicity and inaction during the Gujarat riots of 2002 should not be used against him, because communal riots have happened under other political parties as well. And during the 2014 Lok Sabha campaign, whenever his political opponents brought up the issue of the inaction and the complicity in the riots in Gujarat in 2002, people said, but what happened in 1984 when the Sikh community was targeted in Delhi following Indira Gandhi's assassination? And there appears to be credible evidence which shows that Congress leaders themselves, some of the more important Congress leaders, were involved in enabling those mobs to riot, and in some cases also in calling unruly elements from neighboring districts to specifically attack Sikh households. So very often the argument was that you can't specifically accuse the BJP of orchestrating communal violence, because the Congress has also done it in the past, which might be a part of political rhetoric, right? After all, if you're accused of something, you want to respond by also putting the opponent on the floor. So as a rhetorical device in those elections, I think it worked. And it also made communal violence a non-issue in the 2014 Lok Sabha elections, where the focus was more on the ability to make decisions about economic policy, the ability to make firm decisions, and the rejection of dynastic politics, which I guess was the bigger problem with the Congress. But what commentators on communication studies have shown is that this was nothing else but an argument based on whataboutry. Because rather than thinking about what needs to be done in the next 5 years, what kind of promises need to be made to voters in terms of what constructively can be done for the next few years, the entire discussion from both sides, I'm not saying one side, the discussion from both sides was hinging on the past. Now, you might say that if a particular political leader has demonstrated evident biases against a minority community, or a particular political leader simply was incapable of handling a serious security crisis, then that's a big question mark about that person's ability to lead the country. And that is maybe the argument which the Congress was making in that context. But the fact that another serious wrong, a comparable wrong, in fact, a much worse wrong, has also happened in the past cannot be sometimes an automatic argument to rebut it, right? The argument should be that even if mistakes were made in the past, or even if omissions were made in the past, which led to large-scale riots, maybe it was a case of administrative inexperience at that time, maybe emotions were running high, right? So the better course is to talk about how can we think about peace building in the future, right? So the problem with the arguments about whataboutry is that rather than concentrating on what needs to be done to improve the collective situation to prevent that problem from happening again, so rather than learning the right lessons from history, we start engaging in personal attacks on each other by saying, oh, you said this when this happened, you said that then when this happened. And there's no real limit to the extent of time, to the extent where you can go into the past to say this is why you're inconsistent. Now, one of the problems with the politics of the Hindu right is that they often bring up things which are completely unrelated to the subject matter in front of you. So I'm not saying that was the case with the discussion on communal riots, because both the major parties have in fact been complicit in organizing major riots in different parts of the country, right? And the same thing can be said for some of the smaller regional parties as well. But to take discussions about modern-day secularism back to, let's say, a situation that occurred 500 years ago with no clear evidence of whether or not a temple was in fact destroyed or not, or whether or not there was in fact a deliberate attempt to deny Hindus a place of worship, and to construct this mythology that there used to be a temple. So these are all arguments, right, which are not beyond the realm of fact-finding. So in effect, what we have is a situation where when you start engaging in a process of whataboutry, the argument moves away from facts, it moves away from what needs to be done, what needs to be planned for the future, towards, let's say, competing claims about what happened in the past. And I think we need to ask ourselves whether or not this kind of communication helps in the long run, right? It might help in the limited context of a criminal trial where you have to protect your client and you have to point out inconsistencies in the prosecution testimony or the prosecution evidence. But when you're trying to resolve deep-seated questions of religious prejudice, caste prejudice, right, you have to think about arguments which build upon ideas of collective responsibility rather than, let's say, apportioning the blame on one group and then facing retaliation that the other group was responsible. So that's the real problem that we have had in our politics in the last 10 years. And I'm finding that this approach is also seeping into the way in which ordinary people talk. Not just students or academics, but also ordinary people have in fact become far more vengeful, far more spiteful, because that is the kind of discourse we are seeing and we are consuming every day on our social media feeds or in our WhatsApp groups. So this is a point which I'm just bringing up in a technical sense, but it is a problem with the way in which we construct our discourse at large as well. And the last point, of course, I guess, which relates more to the problem of fake news or disinformation is the misrepresentation of evidence. But as a matter of rebuttal also, you can point out when you feel the other side is misrepresenting the evidence and is not presenting it with the right kind of background or explanation that is required. So obviously, I've gone beyond the needs and requirements of your term papers, but it may be useful to think through whether or not you're seeing examples of these methods of refutation or rebuttals in the materials that you're collecting with the topic in mind. So we can look at one more slide, which basically is just a restatement of how we present arguments in legal memos, normally legal memoranda. So generally, you follow what is called the IRAC form, the IRAC form. It's a very useful format, especially for your law exams. Not so useful in the social sciences, because in the social sciences, rather than taking sharp positions, you often try to explain and develop what your opinion is on a certain issue. But especially in subjects which require you to analyze the interpretation of a particular rule or to analyze a comment on a particular judgment, the IRAC format is highly recommended, right? Where you state the applicable issue, what really is the real issue of disagreement, either when it comes to the interpretation of a rule, a proposal for reform, or an argument that has taken place between different parties, followed by a statement of the rule, which is a statement of the applicable doctrine. What is the relevant statute? What is the relevant administrative rule or the judicial decision that is relevant to this discussion? If you are working with international legal sources, of course, you think about the relevant provisions of the treaties or the agreements which are connected to your discussion. Then you engage in a process of analysis, which is similar to the process of reason giving or substantiation, which is usually in a case comment or opinion piece. It is normally a discussion of reasons leading up to the position that are being taken by the lawyer, the advisor, or the judge. And then, of course, you conclude by stating the position that you are endorsing or defending. So this is a very basic form, which in a way corresponds with the previous slide on construction of arguments. But the reason I'm framing them as two separate slides for you is that when you start writing, you also need to be able to distinguish what is the overall purpose of the written product that you're creating. So generally, when you approach seminar papers and when you flag out sub-issues in your seminar papers, it might be more useful for you to follow this structure of constructing arguments. And remember, reason giving and substantiation is the central part of what you are expected to do. And the quality of reason giving and substantiation is what really helps you in improving your score. And when you try to publish your work, it helps in improving the chances of your work getting accepted in good journals, right? Of course, when you deal with knowledge from other disciplines, then the quality of empirical research that you're citing or the way in which you have generated your own data also becomes an important part of the writing process. But when you're writing exam answers or when you're writing short memoranda in a legal context, either in litigation or in corporate law, then following the IRAC format, I think, is a useful device to be able to present your answers in a more structured and a more coherent way. So I think I'll stop there for today because I have some sample topics which I thought we can discuss, but this worked better when it came to a classroom discussion where we could break the class into smaller groups and ask you to brainstorm the issues and try and present the arguments in a structured way. I'm not sure if it will work very well in the online form. So I'll just take a couple of sample extracts, not from this slide. I mean, in the presentation, I have some sample topics on media ethics, which we have used in the previous years. But this year, I'll change. I'll change the topic and I'll pick up a couple of abstracts from some recent news items, which I'll display in the class tomorrow. And I will ask you to think about arguments in a structured way when we start reading those extracts and also in terms of how you construct your own responses. So we'll change the format of the exercises that we are going to have in class, because with the online format, we obviously can't go with the conventional group discussion format. So before we proceed, before I conclude for today, any questions so far? Any questions, thoughts, or comments? Okay, so for some of you, I feel, I guess this might be very basic material because you have done this or practiced this in the past. But as you would know, the LLM is a very diverse class. There are some students who have done a program where they did projects and term papers regularly. So for them, this material might be relatively easier. But there are also students with us who have only done semester-end exams or in some cases, even year-end exams. And they may not be used to the process of preparing projects or term papers. So which is why I'm trying to follow a more bare bones approach so that we take everybody along, right? That's also an important part of creating an effective learning atmosphere. So any thoughts or views on this structure which I'm suggesting, or do you think we can improve this further? I mean, sometimes your feedback helps me in improving the content for the future batches as well, right? Or maybe, right, especially when it comes to rebuttals or refutation, I guess with the examples, things will become clearer. So I have picked out three or four extracts, especially from recent newspaper articles, and I want to just first go through them to illustrate how the author has developed their arguments, and then to also see strategies for rebuttals or refutations being applied to those very same extracts. So as I said, please start looking at the first article on logic for law students, which I had shared with you. And in that article, there is an explanation of how we think about our deductive syllogisms, inductive generalizations, and reasoning by analogy. So if required, I'll open up that text in the class as well. But the examples there are American-centric. They're not particular to the Indian context. So which is why I want to use a separate set of examples tomorrow, right? And then as if some of you have seen the full presentation, towards the end of the presentation, there's a listing of some persuasive devices, which are normally found in advertising. But we'll go through them systematically because many of these devices are also found in political communication, in business communication, and sometimes we have to be careful about not letting many of these devices play a role when it comes to academic work. So we will talk about these persuasive devices this week, which you can find in slide number 16 to 21. But tomorrow in particular, I want to take you through some examples because so far, I guess the discussion has been fairly abstract and theoretical. So it always helps to take a tangible set of examples and then try and see whether we can see a particular approach towards the construction of the argument and what kind of strategy has been used to construct the rebuttal. So that's what we'll try and do in the next couple of classes. Then we'll move on to a discussion of some of these persuasive devices, which I think can be done in less than an hour. And then next week, we'll talk a little bit more about how to organize your literature review, how to conduct more targeted searches on legal databases, and then follow it up with a discussion on citation norms and the use of the anti-plagiarism software, which is also something that is sometimes new for students at this stage. So if there are no more comments or questions, I can close there. I guess it's Monday morning, so not everybody would be in their most active stage of the day. So I'll stop there and then we'll meet tomorrow at 10 o'clock.